the King of Kings. We honor you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. We glorify your holy name. Thank you, Lord. We give you praise. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. I glorify your name. I glorify your name. In all the earth, oh God, in all the earth, I glorify your name, I glorify your name, in all the earth.
Your name be glorified in every life. May your name be glorified in every situation. May your name be glorified forevermore. And we sing, hallowed be that name that saved us. We say, hallowed be that name that redeemed us. We say, hallowed be that name that we love so much. We say, hallowed be that name that changes situations and circumstances. Thank you for your mighty presence, oh God. That name that ushers in the presence of the Holy Ghost, thank you. That name that opens the heaven doors, that name that causes the dead to rise, that name that causes every dead thing to come back to life, we all know it. Thank you, oh God. Glory be to your holy name. Thank you, my Father. Thank you, my King. You alone are worthy, Spirit of the living God. Have your way. Have your way this evening. Have your way. Speak. Give direction. Bring illumination. Bring understanding. Help us to know by revelation what you have given us. Help us, Holy Spirit, that our eyes be open. Thank you, Holy Spirit. I depend today on your ministry. I recognize your ministry, Holy Spirit. And I thank you because that ministry is activated even now in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Breathe upon every life. I thank you because there is no distance in the realm of the Spirit tonight. Wherever people are connected from, I ask your touch. I ask your hand. I ask the move, the mighty move of your Spirit that is within them. Thank you, Holy Spirit. We glorify your holy name. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Blessed be your holy name. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Glory be to the Most High God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. We're going to take some time to do some stirring up in our spirits. But before then, let's try and lay some ground rules. Because there are certain things that God is going to do today, especially if you come to the place of understanding. The difference between those that have been impacted by today's meeting and those that will just hear the message is one word called understanding. Jesus said that seed that was planted by the good farmer, he said it fell by the wayside. And the reason it fell by the wayside is not because the farmer didn't do a good job. It's not because the seed was corrupt. The seed was perfect. The farmer did his job. But the problem with the seed and the problem with the result, the problem with the harvest lay solely on one thing. The Bible said that particular soil is a kind that lacks understanding. So before we go into what we have today, you're going to ask God, give me understanding of your word. If you don't ask the Lord and he doesn't give you understanding, you will hear the English language. You will hear what I'm saying with your physical ear. But the understanding will not come. And the moment the understanding does not come, the experience will also be denied you. That is the difference between the boys in the kingdom and the generals in the kingdom. That is why 20 people will sit and listen to the same preaching. But 1, 2, 3 people run with that message and their lives are completely changed. While the other remain exactly where they were before that message was shared. What is missing is that singular word called understanding. There's something called the spirit of understanding. The Bible tells us in the book of Luke chapter 24, the Bible says, and Jesus had to open their understanding that they might understand the scripture. It's a spiritual work that the Spirit of God has to do. Why don't you ask God, give me understanding of these truths. Give me understanding of these truths. Don't let me be blind. Don't let my outer ear hear, yet my inner ear doesn't hear. Remember the Bible said that he who has an ear, let him hear. He had nothing to do with the physical ear. He said, if you have spiritual ears, then hear. But if you have only physical ears, well, I have no comment to that. So that's what I'm going to ask God. Open my spiritual ear. Open my spiritual ear. Take away confusion. Take away distraction. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Only you can activate understanding. I ask for an expression of the spirit of understanding to every ear and every heart that is going to listen today. Thank you, Father. In the name of Jesus. Amen. When Jesus was here on earth, one of the things you will notice about Jesus as you study the Bible, as you read the Bible, is that he was an extremely controversial person or extremely controversial pastor or preacher or man of God or whatever. It was very controversial. And many of the things or sentences that Jesus made will be upside down in the mind of the Pharisees, the Sadducees, and the scribes, and even the multitude. Many of the things he will say, the people will be like, what are you saying? This is not what we've always known. In fact, one of the times Jesus came and told them, he said to them, if you don't eat my bread, if you don't eat my body and drink my blood, you are not part of me. In fact, they were so upset with him. The Bible says that many of his disciples that day, they decided, you see this following of Jesus, we're going to end it today. Because he said things that were extremely controversial. Another time again, Jesus preaching now said to them, ye are gods. They actually, that particular time when he said, you are gods, he pulled it from something that Moses had said. He said, I'm telling you that you are God. That should be your John chapter 10, verse 36. And he said, the scripture cannot be broken. The moment Jesus made that statement, the Bible said that this time they were so upset with him, they took stones and wanted to stone him. This is not a matter of walking away from, you know, what Jesus has said, just like the other one. The Bible said that the disciples decided they are no more going to walk with him. But this time in John chapter 10, verse 34, you know, the Bible tells us that's true, that they took up stones to stone him when Jesus said, but ye are gods. So I want us to start by analyzing that statement. Jesus answered them, is it not written in your law? I said, ye are gods. And they were confused. How can anybody be a god? What is it that makes Mr. X or Mr. Y a god? Why would Jesus look at Peter, James, Matthew, whatever, Philip, whatever their names are, and call them gods? Why did he say that? Is it because there's something special about Philip or Paul or Bartholomew or any of those guys that he called gods? No. Let me tell you why he said to them that ye are gods. And that is why I asked for the spirit of understanding is something you need to pray about. The reason Jesus said that is because of the quality of the spirit that is inside a man that is regenerated. That spirit that you have received, when the Holy Spirit comes inside of you, of course, you know that at salvation, when you give your life to Christ, the person that comes and dwells in your heart is not Jesus. Jesus is in the right hand of the Father and all that, doing so many things for us. The person that comes to live inside of you is the person called the Holy Spirit. Now, when he comes to live inside of you, he changes the constituency of your spirit, man. As a matter of fact, he gives you a brand new spirit. That human spirit that you have received is in the same class as God. The spirit of somebody that is regenerated is not the same with a man that is not regenerated. The spirit of a born-again believer is very different. It's not the same as somebody that is not saved. They are in two different classes. The spirit of a man that is born again, that spirit is in the same class with God. What does that mean? It means that the spirit of God breathed directly into the man. And he receives a spirit that is in the same class as God. That is why when Jesus said you are God, he's not referring to Philip, the body of Philip, or the body of Peter, or my body, or your body. He's referring to the quality of the spirit that is on your inside. That one, the spirit of an unbeliever, is not the same as the spirit of a believer. But let me push you one step further. The spirit of a believer that is ignited, that is on fire, that is contacting God daily, is not at the same level with one who is born again and is docile. What that means is if my spirit is activated, if I'm on fire for God, if there's fresh oil raining on my life, this capacity of my spirit is different from you who are cold or lukewarm. They are completely different. We're going to look at it today and delve into some things And I trust God that by today, somebody's spirit is going to rise up. Somebody's going to become what God has planned for him to do. So let's do an x-ray of this spirit that you have received. What does it look like? I don't think we understand the capacity of the spirit that we carry on our inside. And all the time Jesus was here, that is what Jesus was trying to get us to see. That the moment a man received Jesus, what is inside him is not the same as what is inside the other person that has never received Jesus. And when a man is activated and alive, when a man is praying, when a man or a woman has a healthy secret place, his spirit condition is not the same as someone that is lukewarm. They are completely different. Can we take a look at the capacity of the human spirit that has been touched by the Holy Ghost? You know that anything the Holy Ghost touches changes completely. It's just like a king coming to live in the house of a poor man. That house will not be the same. He's going to rearrange the structure of that house. But let's take a look at the capacity. How big is the human spirit that has been touched by God? So let's start from Ecclesiastes chapter 3 verse 10. Let's begin to look at what is the capacity of the human spirit. Verse 11 of Ecclesiastes chapter 3. He said he has made everything beautiful in his time. Also, he has put eternity in their hearts. This is New King James. If you read King James, even though we don't have to turn there, he says, this one says, New Living Translation says, he planted eternity where? In the human heart. So how big is the human heart? How big is the human spirit? On that translation says, he planted the world in their hearts. In your mind, you think that the human spirit is as small as your body. That's what you think. But the Bible says it is so large. It has so much capacity that God wrapped eternity and put it inside the human soul. How big is the capacity of the human mind, of the human spirit, or the human heart that has been touched by the Holy Ghost? It is not the same as somebody who has never received Jesus. Let's do some other work about this same capacity of the Holy Spirit. Let's take a look at 1 John 2:20, still dealing with the spirit, the human spirit of a person who has given his life to Christ. The Bible says, but you are not like that. For the Holy One has given you his spirit, and you know all truth. Let's read it from King James. I like the way he puts it. Okay, this is fine. He said, but you have an anointing from the Holy One, and you know all things. Who is the you he was talking about there? He was referring to the human spirit of a man that has given his life to Christ. The Bible said that person knows all things. What does it mean to know all things? What do they call God? Omniscience. That's why he said the class of the spirit you have received is the same class as God. That's your spirit that has been touched by God. The Bible said that spirit knows all things. That spirit knows when you are going to die. That spirit knows everything about your destiny. He knows your tomorrow. He knows when you are about to make a mistake. He knows when you are about to take the wrong thing. He knows every single thing. The Bible says, and you know. He didn't say you know some things. The Bible says, you, talking about that spirit that has been touched by God. He said, you know all things. It is very different from somebody who doesn't know the Lord at all. Completely different. That is a capacity. It has an omniscience capacity. That's your spirit. It's more than what you think. It's fatter than what you think. It is bigger than what you think. It is larger than what you think. Your human spirit is fatter than your body. You know, in our minds, because this is how our bodies are. So in our heads, when we think about our spirit, we think of one tiny creature that is stuffed inside. But the Bible is telling us that spirit has omniscience quality. He knows all things. Hallelujah. Let's do a little bit of work. Let's dig a little further as we keep exploring the spirit. Let's look at John chapter 7 verse 38. Jesus was also trying to teach us the capacity of the spirit of a man. Two of them. Number one, the one that is saved and is calm, is quiet, he's not activating the spirit, he's not prayerful, he's not studying, he's not developing his walk with God. That one is part one. But there are these other ones who stir up. They are active for God. They are on fire for God, which is why I now understand why the Lord said, make sure that the fire does not go down. Because when that fire, when that oil, when your fellowship with God starts going down, the capacity of the spirit begins to reduce. It begins to shrink. So this is what he said. He who believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his, another King James says, out of his belly Which belly is he talking about? It's not this physical belly. He said, out of his belly, look at what will flow out of the belly. Look at what will flow out. The belly he's talking about is the spirit man. Look at what will flow out of the spirit man. He said, shall flow. How many things? Did you notice he didn't say river? Already one river is big enough. But now he's talking to you. He said, out of the spirit of a man who is saved, there are locked up rivers that are there. He said, rivers of what? Living water. Now, if you talk to any marine biologist, if you ask them, is water a living thing? They'll tell you no. Everybody knows water, the water you and I drink. It might supply life, but that water is not living. There's only one living water in the entire universe. And guess where that water is found? It's only located one place, in the spirit of a man who has received Jesus. That's the only place, living water. And the reason the Bible says that there are rivers is because each of these rivers flow for different things. You know, when you're talking about soaked by the Spirit, I know what people's minds went to. Oh, the Holy Spirit is going to pour upon us. No. It is not about the Holy Spirit pouring upon you. It is about the Spirit that is inside. The rivers of living water rising from within and overshadowing you. So the reason the Bible says there are rivers of living water. There is one that is activated when there is sickness. That river goes. The Bible says that there is a throne and there is a river there. And the Bible says it is for the healing of the nation. When that river is activated, anything sickness, the moment that river comes in contact with cancer, it dissolves it. There is another river that is activated when there's depression. Anything that water, that river comes in contact with, it nullifies it. So the Holy Ghost is the one that knows the river that is needed. So he said, out of your belly. So how big is that your belly? How large is your belly? He said, out of your belly, something is going to flow from it. He said, it is called living water. The only place where you can find water that is living. But guess what? Let's compare living water to dead water. As dead as water is, it gives life. As dead as water is, it is what feeds all the fishes. It is what, you know, gives habitation to fishes. It is what gives habitation to certain plants. It is what allows the sheep to go from one place to the other, as dead as it is. Look at the power of dead water. How about the living water that is within you? The problem is that we are not allowing the water to flow out. What is happening in many believers' lives is that the water is stagnant. It is just there. So what we do on a daily basis, we wait for the fresh outpouring of the Holy Ghost. Meanwhile, he's saying the Holy Ghost is not coming anywhere. He's inside you. All you need to do is to learn how to activate him. Let's pull a scripture, Isaiah chapter 60. Let's pull verse 1. Maybe we'll also look at 2. What comes to your mind? Rise, shine. Who was he talking to here? Was he talking to me, the body? Was he talking to the spirit? Who was he really talking to? He said, rise, shine, for thy light is come. He now said, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. Let's analyze the active verb there. What's the active verb there? For those of you in the house, what's the active verb there? Rise. It says, risen upon you. Now, picture this. If something is risen, what does it mean? Is it coming from up to down? Or is it coming from down to up? You know, in our heads, we always think, arise, shine, for the light is come. The glory of the Lord is upon you. So in your brain, you are thinking that there's one glory that is going to come upon you. No, he's saying that the water, the glory, remember what the Bible says? He said, Christ in you is a hope of glory. So the glory is already inside. He's telling the spirit, rise. Why? The glory of the Lord, what? Is risen. The glory is in you, but it's shrouded. It's down. It is weak. The river is stagnant. He said, Spirit, rise. And you see what will happen. He said, Spirit, arise. Shine, for light is come. And what? That glory on the inside is risen upon you. When you're talking about being soaked, what is God talking about? Don't allow your water to be stagnant. You're going to stir it up so that, you know what happens to water? Have you seen water that is boiling? You put it, it's calm. You put it on fire, it begins to boil, it begins to boil. After some time, if you don't put it up, the water will boil so much, it will begin to overflow and it will overshadow the pot. That is what the Bible is talking about, being soaked by the Spirit. The Spirit that is inside you, even this Holy Ghost you're looking for, where is this address? Inside of you. Where is the glory of God? The Bible says Christ in you. That is the hope. What does that mean? If you allow Christ in you to be dormant, there is no hope of glory. If you allow Christ in you to be calm, there is no hope of glory. So that's what the Bible says. Creation is waiting for the manifestation of the sons of God. Where are the sons of God? They are the ones that are allowing the Spirit to be calm on their inside, waiting for another outpouring from somewhere. Let me tell you, verse 2 of that Isaiah 60. Why does the Spirit need to arise and shine? Let me tell you. He said, because darkness shall cover the earth, and gross darkness will cover the people, but the Lord shall again arise upon thee. So where was the Lord here? What are they saying? Where do you think the Lord is when he's arising? If he's in heaven, they will say the Lord shall what? Descend upon you. But now they are telling us the Lord shall what? Rise upon thee. In other words, he shall grow from the inside out, and his glory shall be seen upon you. In other words, if you don't rise and shine, that glory that is inside will not be seen. That means anytime you see darkness, anytime you see a problem, anytime you are faced with a situation, let me give you an advice. Because as the days are going and crime is on the increase and all sorts of things are on the increase, I'll give you a tool for success. Every time you see the glory, or every time you see darkness, what is God saying? Arise. How do you arise? Shut your eyes. I was telling someone yesterday, I said, listen, if you are ever kidnapped, or an armed robber ever comes to your house with a gun, or you are ever in a tight corner, open your mouth and let the glory rise. If they say shut up, increase your voice, because your future, your destiny depends on that thing you are doing. The kidnapper will say, shut up, we'll shoot you. It is better to die speaking in tongues than to keep quiet. So when you say, Rege bada telebo shata, you are waiting for the glory to rise. The moment the glory rises, that bullet cannot fire. That is why watch anybody that is a Christian that has been faced with a gun, whatever. If he begins to speak in tongues, they will tell him, shut up. If he's a foolish man, he'll keep quiet out of fear. The glory needs to rise. However, if you're a person that is not used to activating the glory, it might take you a while for it to rise. You know, like a car you start once a year. When you start it, the engine will be tight. You now have to do it will take a while. But if you're the kind that every morning you start your engine, every evening you start your engine, when there's darkness, it's very simple. 1 minute of talking in tongues and the glory is already activated. For some, they might need 30 minutes. For some, they might need 1 hour. But if you start talking in tongues, the rivers of living water will start flowing. The Holy Ghost knows which river needs to be activated. He knows, is it the river that is going to cause confusion? What do you think? God said, listen, this battle is not yours, Jehoshaphat. He said, it is mine. Remember, these guys have fasted for some days before the Lord. So the one on the inside had risen. That's why God said to them. Because God made that comment after they had prayed and fasted. Because God was telling them the technology of getting the man on the inside to rise. One of them is prayer. The other one is fasting. Why does fasting help the glory to rise? It subdues the flesh. And then the glory rises. And then God said, you see this battle? Don't be afraid. It is not your battle. It is mine. And guess what happened at the end of the day? The Bible said God caused confusion among them. Why? The river that causes confusion among the heathen was activated. So that river went and it caused confusion. Do you know how many rivers are inside of you? Yet you are in lack. Yet you are defeated by Satan. Let me tell you what God told Timothy. Or rather, Paul told Timothy. Let's take a look at 2 Timothy chapter 1 verse 6. 2 Timothy chapter 1 verse 6. So we'll read verse 6. Then we'll read verse 7. Because most people quote verse 7 without understanding where verse 7 came from. Okay, let's look at verse 7 first. You see what it says. So I notice people just quote, they pull this scripture out of context. For God has not given us spirit of fear, but of power, of love, and of sound mind. But forgetting that there is a 4 there. The for means because. So there is a reason Paul was telling Timothy for. So let's find out what it is in the previous verse. He said, wherefore I put you in remembrance. Why was he putting Timothy in remembrance? Because Timothy had forgotten that there's something that he's carrying. He said that thou stir up the gift of God, which is in thee by the putting on of my hands. Let me explain. So Paul had gone to visit Timothy. Timothy was a young guy. He was 16 when Paul began to pastor him. And then Paul went and laid hands on Timothy, and something was deposited inside Timothy. But after that deposit, Timothy just relaxed. Timothy kept on expecting the Spirit of God to come from heaven. Paul got a report that in Timothy's church, nothing is happening. That in Timothy's life, nothing was going on. Timothy was just there. There was no structure. If you read the Bible, you see there. There was no structure. And because Timothy was a young man, people were despising him because of his age. So nothing was going on in Timothy's church. He was just calm. He was quiet. Then Paul wrote him a letter. He said, listen, Timothy, there are two dimensions. There's a gift of God that is in you. But if you don't stir it up, nothing will happen. I, Paul, I have transferred something on you. But that I have transferred it is not automatic. It doesn't mean it will work. You have to stir it up. You have to get the gift to arise. When I was growing up in ministry, I was not the only one. We're many. But I'll tell you, this was the secret. While they'll teach us, pray for us, minister to all of us, and all of that, everybody will go home. I'll remain in church. What will I do in church? I was doing what's stirring up. I'll take seasons of fasting. I'll take seasons of prayer. I'll take seasons of studying the word. I'll take seasons of meditation. I'll listen to the tapes over and over again. What was I doing? The glory must arise. Others will hear and go back like Timothy. But I said, no. If this thing has been laid on me, this thing must be said. After some time, the difference was clear. Separation began to occur. Because when you stir it up, it can't be hidden. That glory will rise. After some time, the difference was clear. People thought I was more anointed. No, I wasn't more anointed. I only stirred up. The glory of God is in you. Are you stirring it up? Listen, if you're waiting for another God to come from heaven, you're joking. He has come once, he's not coming again. Many of us are waiting, maybe before the second coming, there's one outpouring, one major revival. There is no other revival. That revival is already inside of you. Rivers of living water. Isaiah 59 verse 19. Those of you that are here, you are blessed, because when we log offline, we're going to stir up. We're going to stir up some things tonight. See what the Bible says. Oh, let's go back to Timothy. I need to show you something. Yes. So he said, stir up the gift of God that was in you by what? By the putting on of my hands. Now, let's not go there, so we don't go off track. If you observe Elijah and Elisha transfer, Elisha did not start operating the double portion of Elijah's anointing because Elijah laid hands on him. If that is all Elisha did, nothing would have happened in Elijah's life. But I began to observe about Elisha. After hands were laid on him, that mantle was thrown on him. The Bible said on his way back, because as they were going to, for Elijah to go, they met a river and all of that. So Elijah took his garment, hit it, and he walked by the water and passed. On their return journey, that same obstacle was there. Elisha had two choices. Walk around the river and go to the other side. Or say, wait a minute, I'm not walking around the river. I contacted something 5 minutes ago. I contacted something 30 minutes ago. I contacted something 1 hour ago. I am going to use it. The Bible says he removed that same mantle. He put into practice. He stirred up. If he had walked around the mountain, Elisha would go and be normal. Nothing would have happened. The only thing Elijah would be wondering, but Elijah was powerful. I have contacted the anointing. Why am I not moving? Why am I not soaked in the spirit? Why is nothing going on? Because he has not stirred up. He has not put into practice. He has not talked in tongues. He has not fasted. He has not put into practice. Why didn't Timothy put into practice? Verse 7 tells us. Because. Why wasn't Timothy put into practice? The Bible says four. Another word for four is because. He said, because God has not given him the spirit of fear. In other words, Timothy was afraid. He was looking at himself. I'm a young man. Where will I start from? All these elders in the church, where will I start from? They will say, who dashed me? When did you start speaking in tongues? Who told you? Go and sit down. Timothy was afraid. That's why Paul wrote him another letter. He said, Timothy, don't let anybody despise your youth. Youth, old man, big man, young man in the sight of God is not dependent on your age. It's dependent on your spiritual capacity. He said, don't let anybody despise your youth. Fear was crippling Timothy. Are you like that? Fear has crippled you. You can't do anything. You know, to lay hands on the sick, then I will tell myself, what's the worst that can happen? They won't get healed, is it not? Yes. Okay. Are they going to arrest me because I prayed for the sick and the sick did not recover? The answer is no. Are they going to call police for me because I prayed for the sick and the sick didn't recover? The answer is no. What's the worst that can happen if I go to minister Holy Ghost baptism to somebody and he doesn't receive? The only thing that he will not receive, but they won't call police, they won't take me to jail. What's the worst that can happen if I go to preach the gospel? What's the worst that can happen if I go to my class and announce that there is a healing service? Because then, early in the morning, lecture starts by 8 a.m. So we'll go by 7:30 a.m., walk to the front of the class and announce, students, wait a minute, we're about to hold a healing service now. They'll look at you. I know how students can be. They'll look at you. You say you are what? Is your name Benihin? Then you now stand. He said, in the next 30 minutes, the healing power of God is going to descend on this classroom right now. Even as you're saying, even as I'm saying it, my heart will be like, I hope you know what you are doing. But I said to myself, if they don't get healed, what's the worst that can happen? So guess what? That is the stirring up. I will go, I will say, lift your hand. If you're sick, place your hands where it's hurting you. Jesus is going to heal you right now. Guess what? They will place their hand. I will pray for the sick. Guess what? Wait, though, I can actually hear. My head was aching me. Headache has gone. My back was paining me. Backache has gone. What if I sat in my hostel afraid? What if I never stared up? What if I never went to pray and get soaked in the Spirit of God? I will be like every normal person, not knowing that I'm carrying the deposit of God on my inside. Being soaked by the Spirit is allowing the one that is on the inside to rise. Let's look at Isaiah 59, verse 19. So shall they fear the name of the Lord from the west and his glory from the rising of the sun. Now, this is what I'm looking for. He said, when the enemy comes in like a flood, what will happen? Remember, you have rivers. He said, the enemy will come in like a flood. He said, the Spirit of God will lift up a standard. Where you're talking about lifting? Is it from up to down or down to up? So what does that mean? The Spirit of God is on the inside. When the enemy rises like a flood, if you don't do anything, that river will be calm. The enemy will come, you win. He said the Spirit of God on your inside will stir up a standard against him. It has to rise if you will learn to activate it. Being soaked in this, because there are two things you can be soaked with. You can either be soaked by your flesh, and I'll tell you how to be soaked by your flesh. Or you can be so soaked in the Spirit. When you pray in the Holy Ghost, I'm praying the Holy Ghost, I'm praying the Holy Ghost, I'm praying the Holy Ghost. What's going on is that your flesh is coming down. After some time, because when you don't pray, you're soaked in the flesh. When you don't pray, you're soaked in your mind. When you don't pray, you are soaked in fear. When you begin to pray, the one that is inside is rising. It gets to a temple. It gets to a height. You now experience what is called overflow. It comes from inside and overshadows and overflows you. That's what happens. But we are not activating the one that is on the inside. When the Holy Ghost wants to activate the one on the inside, he wakes you up. Do you know what the Bible says? 1 John 4:4. It's talking about the human spirit now being touched by God. Let's look at 1 John 4:4. You are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. Who is the one in the world? Who can guess? Satan and all his drama. Okay. So picture Satan and all the demons combined. The Bible says that the one that is in you is bigger than them. So how big? What's the capacity of the human spirit? Why is it that Satan is winning if the one on your inside is actually greater? Guess what? The one on the inside is calm. He's just there lying down. The Bible says, whenever the enemy comes like a flood, if you keep quiet, the Holy Ghost, the one on the inside will be calm. The Holy Ghost needs your cooperation. He needs your partnership. We have raised a generation of lazy believers, a generation of fearful believers who cannot take a step. The greatest discovery I made is asking myself a question. What is the worst that can happen? What is the worst that can happen? The highest is they will not get healed. But I've tried it time and time and time again. You pray, they get healed. You preach, they get saved. You organize program. I won't even have money. I'll say, we are going to have heaven's night. No naira. But I want people to experience the power of God. By faith, you step out there. And as you begin to pray, all kinds of things start arising. And you are so soaked that your mind starts functioning. At that point, it's only the mind of God that is functioning. Until you rise up, you can never be soaked by the Spirit of God. It's easy for me to come today and say, Holy Ghost fire, fall on us, fall on us. Haven't it been falling on you? After it has fallen, what next? That's when you're talking to children. You ask the Holy Ghost to fall on them. But when you want to mature people, you tell them the truth. That the Holy Spirit is inside. Why are you looking for the one outside? The one that is inside. Stir him up. Let him soak you. He said, arise, shine. Why are you rising to shine? He said, whenever you see darkness, lift up tongues. Whenever you see darkness, lift up tongues. I'm saying this because a lot of people have problems. This is the antidote. Anytime you are faced with darkness, whether it's financial darkness, whether it's hell darkness, whatever darkness, talk in tongues. Let me tell you one more thing. As I begin to pull, I think my time is going. Let me tell you one more thing that happens to you. When you activate, when you get soaked, there's something I observed in the Bible. It's called satanic errors. I'll explain what that means. There's something called satanic errors. Do you know what the Bible says? You know Satan will plan. You know he plans. The Bible tells us very clearly that he planned for Peter to see Peter like with, to make him to abandon his work with God. He finished planning. But then, after he has planned, Jesus said, I have prayed for you. Now, I also saw in the scripture, explaining satanic errors, I saw in the scripture that the Bible says, if Satan had known, he would not have crucified the Lord of glory. The biggest error Satan made, he calculated wrongly. He thought that by killing Jesus, that would be the end. That would bring an end to whatever it is that Jesus was doing. He miscalculated. He did not know that by killing Jesus, that would be the beginning of his torment. It's called satanic error. If you want satanic error to occur every day, you have to talk in tongues. Do exactly what Jesus did. That is why he was always praying in tongues. Do you know another satanic error? Allowing Joseph to be sold in slavery. In the mind of Satan, when he saw Joseph, he knew that Joseph, this guy is special. It's like God wants to use him. Because Satan was listening when Joseph said, I saw a dream, 11 stars bowing before you. Because I hope you know Satan can read people's stars. It's in the Bible, they call them necromancer. So he read the star of Joseph, and Joseph even helped him by going about verbalizing what God has showed him in the dream. So before, Satan was guessing about the star of Joseph. They could read the star of Jesus. Is it Joseph's star they can't read? If they can read the star of Jesus, is it your star they can't read? So anyway, they were guessing before. Then Joseph now opened his mouth. Oh, I saw 10 stars and all. So they began to see, this guy is like God wants to use him. And guess what happened? They allowed Satan to be what? They allowed Joseph to be sold in slavery. When Satan saw Joseph in arms and chains being sold into slavery, he was very excited. He did not realize he was making a satanic error. If he had known, he would not have allowed Joseph to be sent into slavery. There are many satanic errors in the Bible, and they come by your talking in tongues. That thing that the enemy thinks is going to destroy you will be the same thing that will lift you. If you study the Bible, you see many satanic errors. Allowing David to be called into the house is a satanic error. That wasn't the plan. There was a time that they closed churches. Of course, you know the story. They closed churches in China. Satan was very happy. It was a satanic error. He didn't know that by closing the churches, then there were about 800,000 churches. By closing the churches, he had just made a satanic error. By the time they realized what was happening, there were over how many millions of churches now planted in China. And Satan said, if only I had known, I would not have closed the churches. It happened in Egypt. It happened in China. It's happening in Nigeria. not just in Nigeria, it's happening all over the world. The more you shut down the churches, the more you are doing what is called satanic error. Do you know how many ministries have been bettered since the lockdown? Do you know the amount of revival that has occurred since the lockdown? People are now connecting online and all sorts of things are going on. It's a satanic error that Satan made. How do satanic errors come? When you allow the one on the inside to rise. There are many things Satan is plotting against you. If you keep quiet, those errors will be the right one. If you allow them to rise. Do you know, for instance, by Satan allowing you to hear me, is that he has made an error. That's if your ear be open. By Satan allowing you to hear me, he has made an error. And in the name of Jesus, may he make more errors in the name of Jesus. He thought he would destroy Jesus. That thing was what brought the end. If you read your Bible in Acts chapter 8 verse 1, there was another satanic error. Can we look at it quickly before we get to pray? Acts chapter 8 verse 1. Now Saul was consenting to his death of Stephen. At that time, a great persecution arose against the church, which was at Jerusalem. Who was sponsoring this persecution? Who was sponsoring it? You already knew Satan. But guess what happened? At that time, a great persecution arose against the church, which was at Jerusalem. And they were all scattered throughout the region of Judea, Samaria, except the apostles. Don't change. Pause. Let's analyze this. So Satan sat down and said, listen, Jesus has gone. We made the first mistake. But now, it seems as though Jesus that we killed, many other Jesus have arisen. So what we're going to do, we're going to put them under pressure. We're going to persecute them. We're going to throw them into the lion's den. We're going to kill them. We're going to destroy them. And all the demons say, yeah, Satan, that's why we like you. You're very smart. So they went into operation. Guess what happened in verse 2? You remember the Bible said they were all scattered abroad. And the Bible said devout men carried him and all that. If you get to verse 4, you get to the point you are looking at. Verse 4. Therefore, those who were scattered went everywhere preaching the word satanic error. If Satan had known, he would not have persecuted the church. At least the gospel would have stayed only in Jerusalem, isn't it? But now he now went and persecuted them. What happened? As they were traveling, they were carrying the message. Stephen, he was from here. They persecuted Stephen. He went to Samaria. Before, Samaria did not hear the gospel at all. Simon of Cyrene was one in charge of Samaria. But the Bible said when Philip entered Samaria, the Bible said he took Samaria. The Bible said people that were sick, lepers, all kinds of people that had paralysis, they were getting healed. And then he brought Simon of Cyrene. That guy, Simon Samaria, he brought that guy, bound the demon under him and brought the guy to church. Satanic error. How do satanic errors happen? When the devil looks at you, he plots your downfall. But when you pray in the spirit, that downfall will cause your rising. That downfall will cause a change. That time when the devil presses you under, if he had known, he would have left you alone. Because when you are under pressure, that is when you begin to talk in tongues. It's when you are under pressure, that is when you remember God. It's when you are under pressure. But some people, when they are under pressure, they forget. They start running from pillar to post. That is the time to ensure that Satan made a mistake. When he causes you to cry, telling Satan you have just made another satanic error. When he puts a disease in your body, telling him you have just made a satanic error. When he causes problem in your life, telling you have just made a satanic error. Because of this thing you have done now, I'm going to rise up to pray. When masquerades chase you in the night, you are sleeping. You're going to say, Satan, for this masquerade, I'm going to win souls this week. Four souls must come into the kingdom. Every time you release a tear because of what Satan did, tell him, because of this tear, you're going to see what will happen in my office. Because of this tear, you're going to see what will happen in my family. You're going to see on my street, there will be a crusade. When you lose your job, tell Satan, it's a satanic error you have made. If you are no, you don't have allowed me to lose my job. Now I have time for God. Hey, now I have time to pray. Now I have time to study. If you had no Satan, if you were wise, you would have left me in that office. Satanic error. But it occurs if a man is able to know how to turn around. Whenever you are pressed against the wall, read that kata. He said, whenever the devil comes against you like a flood, he said, the Spirit of God will raise up a standard. Will you join the Holy Ghost to raise up a standard? Because he's telling you, arise, overshadow, arise, let me soak you. But we are too lazy. to be soaked by the Spirit of God. And instead of Satan making a satanic error, it turns around for his good. Which one do you want? Which one do you want? Which one do you want? If you don't get soaked in the Spirit, darkness will come. Isaiah chapter 60. Darkness will come. Whenever, I'm going to say it again, whenever you are faced with darkness, what should you do? Don't be afraid. Open your mouth. Let the glory rise. The thief will say, shut up, I will shoot. Raise your voice louder. He said, I'm warning you now. If you don't shut up, I will fire you. Rido kaba yede shata. If you are ever kidnapped, don't keep quiet. If your child is ever kidnapped, don't keep quiet. Start talking in tongues wherever you are. As you talk in tongues, the Bible says the rivers of living water, they will start flowing. And as they flow, they get to a point where they overshadow you. And they overshadow that man that has kidnapped your child. We have the solution on our inside. But are we allowing it to rise? No. We only wait for the pastor to come from the mountain and be soaked in the Spirit. Guess what? You still have that power. It amazes me how you finish a program. Preach, preach, preach. Lay hands on the sick. When you finish that thing, you see 50 people line up again. Pastor, come and pray for me. What do you want me to pray? Pray for me to be healed. But the way you know the one I prayed for the whole crowd, he said, that one is the crowd. You just need to say a special one. So when I finish preaching, they will come. They'll say, Pastor, just touch me. I said, but are you not the one? Didn't I speak? He said, hey, just talk. Those ones will remain babies for the rest of their life. They have no intention of growing. Is that where you want to stay? The pastor that is praying for you, where did he get the power from? The same place that pastor got his power, you too can get your power from there. Stop being lazy. Grow up. Stop being lazy. Grow up. If Elijah had not done anything, we will hear that Elijah transferred the power, but we can't find the guy. Guess what? The Bible talks to us that Elijah had a school of prophets. Where were they? We never heard about them again. It's only Elisha we heard about. Why? He implemented. This is the season where separation is going to occur, which is why I've been teaching for a long time about the secret place. It is in that secret place that is where change occurs. That is where power occurs. That is where the one that is in you rises. Have you ever activated the river? You know, for many of us, the river is stagnant. It's just there. It's just stagnant. The river has never flowed. But today I want us to stand. I want us to put into practice. As you begin to activate the river, like I said, if you have not done this before, it might take you 15 minutes. It might take you 20 minutes. Let me tell you how you know it will take you a long time. As we start, inside you, you are angry. You know why you're angry? Wait now. Eh? Why can't she just pray for us so that we'll be healed? Why is she making us do the work of prayer? That's how to know that your river is stagnant. And that it will take you up to 1 hour for that overshadowing to occur. But if it's something you have been doing, the moment you say, let us activate, let us get soaked in the Spirit. There is no other way to get soaked in the Spirit. It is to activate the one that is on your inside. The Holy Ghost touching your spirit man in partnership with the Holy Ghost, your spirit man will rise. It will get to a point where you are overshadowed. Initially, when you start, you'll be in the flesh. And someone is asking, what about me that I don't speak in tongues? Well, when we start praying in the Holy Ghost, I want you to join us. When we cut off from Instagram, if you go to our mixer where the handle Life Edge, you'll see the message or whatever continues from there. If you cannot speak in tongues, I'm just going to pray a very simple prayer and then join us and pray. The Holy Ghost will come upon you. If there's anything wrong in your body, let me tell you how that river flows. If there's a cancer in your body, right? It even flows in normal things. If there's a cancer, there's a disease, there's joblessness, there's stagnation, there are problems in your life. Whatever those problems are, the Bible says there is a river. It is for the healing of the nations. The Bible says, out of your belly, not from heaven. There is no other soaking coming from heaven. The Holy Ghost fell on the day of Pentecost, and that was it. Every other thing is inside of you. If you want any soaking, activate the one inside first before you think of the other one. When the Holy Ghost sees you activating the one on the inside, he cannot partner with your spirit man. Hallelujah. If there's anything, if I can get a glass, there's a glass with water. I want to demonstrate what will happen as you talk in tongues. Get glass and yes, there's a bottle in the house. Can I have it? Just a small cup. Preferably some trust. Yes. quickly, I want to show you something. The pictorial image will help you to partner with us, and then I'll need a tray. Yes, I'll need more than that bottle of water. If there are two bottles of water, that would be great. Can I have a little bit of sand or a leaf? Okay, I think they won't be angry if I cut this leaf. Just a tiny leaf. Yes, come. I need another, but this water won't be enough. So this is what happens to you. Come off stage. This is you, this is you. Now inside of you, this is God's plan for you. But inside, there is, you see this tiny whatever. Is that a lighter leaf? Okay, because this will, I think that should be lighter. Okay, great. If it's a lighter leaf, it'll be easier for us to work with. Let me see this one. Okay, so this one, this is sickness. This is disease. This is stagnation. This is failure. This is joblessness. This is whatever it is. Demonic oppression, all kinds of things. It is inside like this, right? But inside, this is what happens to you. And the Bible is saying, out of your belly, out of your spirit, shall flow river of living water. The only place in the universe where water is alive is inside of you. Wow. That's the capacity of your human spirit. There is no other, the only storage for water that is living is inside of you. So this is what, as you begin to talk in tongues, observe what's going to happen to the river. This is what happens. As you begin to pour more and more, as you are talking in tongues, this thing is shaking. The sickness is shaking. The sickness is shaking. As you keep pouring, watch. The thing is rising. You are talking in tongues. The sickness is still there. I need another tray or a basin. As you keep on pouring, displacement is taking place. As you keep on pouring, that's, I'm pouring because there's no way I can do this from outside. As you keep on doing this, after some time, when you have saturated enough, watch. The river is being expelled. You see that this river, it comes out. Is the river out? Is the tree out? Is the tree out? Did you notice that the tree came out? Did I need to touch the leaf? I didn't need to touch it. All I needed to do was to stir up and let it shatter. If there is any demonic deposit, if there is any failure, if there is any seeking, anything that is not of God, any character that is not of God, if it is planted in you, you don't need to touch the sickness. All you need to do, get soaked. Get soaked. I didn't touch the leaf, but the leaf came out by itself. The leaf came out by itself. What is in you? Is there a work of the flesh? It needs to come out. Is there a disease? It needs to come out. Listen, there are some of you that are carrying the gifts of the Spirit, but they are not in manifestation. Why? You have not learned to soak. 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 Soak yourself. Soak yourself. Soak yourself. There are kids that are inside of you. They need to come out. They need to come out. If I did not soak, I will not be here. If I did not soak, I will not be here. If I did not soak, I will not be here. After hearing a message, I go on my face in the place of prayer. After hearing a message, I'll take a time to fast. After hearing a message, I study. I soak. Go ahead and soak. Go ahead and soak. As you talk in tongues, something's going on. Something's going on. Hey, everybody. Is there lies? Is there lying in you? Soak, soak up, soak up, get soaked. Let the river flow. Let the river flow. Don't be tired. Let the river flow. Why doesn't the river flow? Fear. Why doesn't the river flow? Laziness. That's why the river will not flow. Laziness. That's why the river will not flow. Push, push. Go ahead and soak.
The Father, open up.
There are many Elishas here today. There are many Elishas. There are many Elishas waiting to arise. There are many Elishas. There are many Elishas. There are many Elishas. You will not arise until you soak. You will not arise until you soak. You will not arise. The gift of God is in you. Say it up. It's already in you. Say it up.
Oh, for I am with the Father. Open up.
The gift of prophecy. The gift of prophecy, just the keyboard. The gift of prophecy, Kalele Shaba, is there. Word of knowledge is there. Gifts of healing is there. Working on miracles is there. Prophecy is there. But you need to soak. You need to soak. You need to soak. You need to soak. Do I have a man that wants to soak? Do I have a woman that wants to soak? That's what Elisha did. He soaked. Out of your belly shall flow. Let the river flow. Let the river flow. Let the river flow. Anything that is not of God is being expelled. Anything not of God is being expelled. Anything not of God is being expelled. When you soak, angels are released. When you soak, demons go. When you soak, visions become clear. Dreams become clear. Divine visitation occurs. Channels of your spirit, they open up. Satanic arrows will begin to occur in your life. Satanic arrows begin to occur. Tell yourself, enough of this level. Enough of this level. Enough of this level. Those who are made it, they don't have two heads. They don't have three heads. I decide today, I am going to rise. I decide today, I am going to rise. Like Elijah, I soak. Like Timothy, I soak. Like Paul, I soak. After Paul had an encounter, the Bible said, for 3 years, he went to Arabia to soak. He began to have visions. He began to have dreams. There is no holiness without soaking. There is no holiness without soaking. You will continue to struggle with sin unless you learn to soak. As you soak in a place of prayer, all those debris, all those sickness, all those disease, all those stagnation, they are expelled. Makalebo shatelele kayaban delele kayabaso rebo. Marrede kayabo shalaban delele kayaban dolebo. I took a young lady recently on a journey of praying in tongues. I took her on a journey and said, begin to talk in tongues. As she listened to me, she started praying in tongues 1 hour every day. 1 hour every day. She did it for just 1 week. All of a sudden, calls began to come. Today, she called me. She said a multinational company gave her a contract. Only one of them, what amount, the millions will be worth. In the season of dryness, a woman who soaked is getting divine encounters financially. People who soak will begin to see visions and dreams. People who soak will understand their purpose. The anointing of God comes upon a man and a woman who soaks. Thank you, Lord. The channels need to open up. The reason you are struggling to pray, you have not done it for a long time. The reason you are struggling, you have not done it for a long time. But don't go ahead, don't be worried. Hey, don't be tired. Don't be tired. Push beyond your last limit. Push beyond your last limit. Go ahead. Let the one rise. Rivers of living water. Rivers of living water. Rivers of living water, let them flow. There are rivers. One river is activated. What of the other one? One river is activated. What of the other river? Let the other river open up. The other river that dispels sin. The other river that dispels the flesh. Let the other river open up. Hey. There is a river that is for the gifts of the Spirit. When that river is activated, word of knowledge begins to come. Working on miracles begin to come. Prophecy begins to come. Working on miracles begin to come. Descending of spirits begin to come. That is the river that Paul was telling Timothy, stir up. Stir up. There's another river that is for healing. There's another river that is for healing. That one needs to be activated. There's another river for joy of the Lord. Where there is depression, where there is heaviness, where there's depression, that river is activated. Go ahead and soak. Go ahead and soak. Get soaked. Get soaked. Get soaked. When you are soaked, nobody will tell you. When you are soaked, nobody will tell you. Tell the Holy Ghost, help me. Help me. Help me to soak. Help me to soak. Let me get wet. Let me get drenched. Let me get drenched. Let me get drenched. Let me get drenched. When you are drenched, nobody will tell you. You will know. You'll be like a drunk man. You'll be like a drunk man. You'll be under the influence. You'll be under another influence. You'll be under another influence. The Holy Ghost is coming on you. He's helping you. He's helping you. Go ahead. There's another river that needs to be activated. That will cause a satanic error. That will cause a satanic error to occur in your life. That's what the enemy has planned for evil. The Lord turns it around for your good. There's another river. That is the river mentioned in Isaiah 59. That is the river mentioned in Isaiah 59. The Bible says, when the enemy comes like a flood, there is a river that is activated to cause satanic error. Go ahead. The river in Isaiah 59. Go ahead and activate it. Everything the enemy has planned against you will scatter in the name of Jesus. There is a river that causes revival. There is a river that causes revival. That is the one that is mentioned in Zechariah. Cry out, the river of revival. The river of revival. The river of revival. Tell the Lord. Tell the Lord, revive me, O God. Revive me, O God. Revive me, O God. I want more of you, O God. I want more of you, O God. Lord, I am struggling in my spiritual life. Help me, O God. I am struggling in my prayer life. Help me, O God. Holy Ghost, help me. Help me. You can't get tired. You can't get tired. You can't get tired. Let the river enter every day from July to December. Let the river enter every day from January to December. Let July be filled with the river. Let July be filled with the river. Let August be filled with the river. Overflowing river in August. Overflowing river in August. Overflowing river in September. Let there be no dry day. Let there be no dry day. Let there be no dry day. Eyado ya kalabo shata. Nege 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 nda da 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 kayabo ya da da kalabo. Has the other influence taken over? Has the other influence taken over? Has the other influence taken over? Ade shalaban de de de. The leaf needs to go out. That leaf needs to go out. Every foreign body needs to go. It needs to go. Suck enough, that leaf will go. Suck enough, that leaf will go. Suck enough, that leaf will go. Sickness cannot stay. Dryness cannot stay. Stagnation cannot stay. Fruitlessness cannot stay. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Holy Ghost, rise up within them. Let your spirit rise up. Let your spirit rise up. Let your spirit rise up. Let the glory of the Lord begin to show forth. Let the glory that is trapped. Let the glory that is trapped. There's a glory, it is trapped. There's a glory inside. There's a glory inside. There's a glory inside. There's a glory inside. It is trapped. Let it come out. Let it come out. The Bible says, and Jesus prayed. And Jesus prayed. His countenance began to change. His countenance began to change. His countenance began to change. He began to see Moses. He began to see Elijah. His eyes were open. His eyes were open. Why? Jesus allowed the one on the inside to show. The one on the inside to show. There's a trap glory. There's a trap glory. We have this treasure. We have this treasure. We have this treasure in earthen vessels. There's a treasure. There's a treasure. The world is waiting for you. Heaven is depending on you. The cloud of witnesses, they are waiting. Catherine Coleman, she's waiting for the glory on my inside to arise. Kenneth Hagin, he's waiting for the glory to arise. Because Kenneth Hagin soaked in prayer. He soaked in prayer. The glory came out. When you soak in prayer. R.W. Kenyon is waiting. R.W. Kenyon, the cloud of witnesses. The cloud of witnesses. They are cheering you on. They are encouraging you. They are saying, don't give up. Don't give up. David is saying, don't give up. Elijah is saying, don't give up. Elisha is saying, don't give up. I went through this process. I went through this process. This is how I became a general. This is how I began to divide the sea. I soaked. I soaked. I soaked. Elijah introduced himself. He said, I am Elijah. I stand in the presence of the Lord. I am Elijah. I stand in the presence of the Lord. That is why I can command the heavens to be locked. And the heavens to be locked. Because I soak. Because I soak. Because I soak. Let the grace to pray. Let the grace to soak. Let the grace to soak. Let the grace to soak. Let it rest. Let it rest. The Bible says the spirit of intercession and supplication. Let it rest on us. That even the season of the night we cannot sleep. In the seasons of the night we cannot sleep. That sleep is withdrawn from you. That you begin to hate your bed. You begin to hate your bed. You begin to hate your bed. Dekade yebo shata kade yebo radada. The Lord is risen. On Saturday we had the prophecy. He said the Lord is raising sons. The Lord is raising sons. There is no other way sons are raised. There is no other way daughters are raised. Akagaga devosha. No son has ever arisen without soaking. No son has ever arisen without soaking. No daughter has ever arisen without soaking. Every one of them, they soaked. Every one of them, they soaked. Every one of them, they soaked. You cannot arrive unless you soak. Hey, labakadagade. Let the rivers flow. Let the rivers flow. Let the devil shatter. After some time, separation will occur. After some time, separation will occur. After some time, separation will occur. They got a ball shatter. They got a ball shatter. Ask God for grace. Tell him for grace. I don't want this to end today. I don't want this to end today. The grace to soak. The grace to soak up. To soak up. To soak up in prayer. Let it rest on me, O God. Let it rest on me, O God. This is the season for prayer. This is the season for the second place. After this time, there will be another season. But I'm telling you now, this is the season for the second place. Daughters are being raised. Sons are being raised. Elijahs are being raised. Elishas are being raised. Mary is being raised. Hey, Mary was raised at the feet of Jesus. A prophecy came two Saturdays. He said, I will pour. 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 He cannot that is ready. He can only pour on that one that is ready. He will not pour on the main road. He will not pour in the workplace. He will pour in the second place. He will pour in the second place. He will pour in the second place. Men of the second place. Women of the second place. That is where God raises the next generals. The next generation of Elishas. The next generation of Elishas. The next generation. Mary knew how. Mary knew how. Mary knew how. This is the season. This is the season to sit at the feet of Jesus. This is the season to sit at the feet of Jesus. Joshua arose by the second place. Joshua arose by the second place. The Bible says, even when Moses would leave the tent, Joshua departed not. Joshua departed not. After the service, Joshua continued. After the service, Joshua continued. That was why they selected Joshua. That was why they selected Joshua. Joshua knew how to soak. He knew how not to depart from the tabernacle. The Bible said Joshua departed not. Joshua was a man of the secret place. Joshua was a man of the tabernacle of God. No wonder he could point to the sun and tell the sun, stand still. The sun obeyed the voice of a man who could stay in the secret place. The sun obeys the voice of a man who can stay in the secret place. A man of the tabernacle. A man of the tabernacle. A man of the secret place. Thank you, Jesus. We give you the glory. The grace to continue pressing on. The grace to continue pressing on. Let it abide on this ones. Anyone under the sound of my voice, I ask for help. I ask for the grace to pray. I ask for the grace to soak. I ask for the grace to be a man of the tabernacle. I ask for the grace to be a man of the tabernacle. There is no rising without the tabernacle experience. There is no general without the tabernacle experience. Without the tabernacle experience. Tell the Lord, give me a tabernacle experience. Give me a tabernacle experience. It is that experience that will not allow you to leave the second place.
I need your secret place.
Channels of my spirit open up. Go
channels
ahead.
Channels of my spirit.
Speak to your ear to open up. Speak to your ear to open up. Speak to your eye to open up. Speak to your heart to open up. Speak to the river to open up. Speak to the river to open up. All those clogged pipes.
No boundaries. All those clogged pipes.
Let them open up. All those clogged pipes. Let them open up.
Let deep call on to deep opener. Oh, the channels of my spirit open up. Jesus, I am with the Father, open up. Oh, no boundaries, no limits. Open up.
Channels of my spirit open up even now.
Channels of my spirit.